Thank you, Phil. And thank you all for being here. These are glorious events. You get to meet old friends, make new friends. And those of you just starting out in science, you meet fellow scientists from other countries working on the very same problems that you are, and you'll hopefully will build relationships that you'll have for your whole career. So I'd like to, you know, Phil is a pretty special guy, as you probably all know. His training was flawed like mine, but somehow we managed. We have the, he has the great benefit now in this meeting, this fantastic facility, this wonderful institute and a center which has been recently established to do his work and all of our work. So I thought UC was going downhill, but coming here, I don't know. Certainly not at UCLA. I was at UCLA for a few years. Just to give you some slight indication of when that was, gasoline was 25 cents a gallon. Can you believe that? There were, you go out on the freeway, there was only about a third as many cars on the freeway as there are now. Population was 15 million. It's now at 38 million. So things have changed a lot, but Phil hasn't. All right, let me, I'm gonna, please indulge me a little bit. I'm gonna do a little bit of memory lane here first before I get into where we're going, where I think we're all going in the future and the problems that we face. So I wanna go back to the the first Medicos meeting and the events leading up to that. This is a wonderful thing. You don't have to point it any particular way, any direction will go forward, I think. Well, this is the result of the first meeting. First meeting was in 1971 and was published in 1973. It was held in Valdivia. And there's a story about why it was held in Valdivia. A beautiful book was produced. I think it's a beautiful book. Look at that cover. That cover was very crucial, actually. That was by Dan Axelrod's paper. It showed us that the climate hasn't always been Mediterranean climate in the regions that we're studying, and many of the plants and organisms have evolved under somewhat different climates than they are in today. This was volume number 7 of the ecological study series. We're now up to 216. Mr. Springer himself came to my office at UCLA to encourage us to publish his book in his new series. Here is the first meeting. We were very formal in those days, neckties and stuff. But the guy to the right of me on the left, that is me on the left, is Francesco De Castro. I'll tell a bit more about him, but he was very important scientist in our field internationally, and he was important in this particular area of the Medicos. And he was not only a great scientist, a great visionary, but he was an enormously adept politician. On the right-hand side, when we went down there for our first meeting, we got to meet the president of the country because this project was so important. He convinced the President Allende that this was really an important project. And he did the same thing wherever post that he held. Good science, good connections, good savvy about how things work. So just a quick summary of some of those, the development of the first two programs I'm just going to talk about. It all starts with Alexander von Humboldt, who inspired us all in so many ways. So many generations of scientists have been inspired by his work, certainly inspired my first sabbatical when I was here at UCLA. I went down to Chile and I thought, well, gee, well, why don't I look at some of the things that von Humboldt did. He said climate and, he didn't say fire, but climate and fire were really important drivers of the structures of vegetation. When you had the same climate complex, you would result in the same structure. We wanted to see, was it the same function also? That's what we were testing. And so that, and we were lucky going down to Chile because there was an amazing program funded by the Ford Foundation where they said, we can, we would like to help develop the University of Chile, build, bring them more resources, and they developed 10 years to all levels, not just science, but poetry, literature, everything, and exchange faculty between, and students between the University of Chile and the University of California. And that was an opportunity for me on sabbatical to go down and start the work there. And that's where I, and that was also important, this program, which lives today, lives on today, actually. Rob Caldwell was at University of California, Berkeley. He had a, had a one of the students came up from Chile, Eduardo Fuentes, and then Eduardo Fuentes went back to Chile, and he had Fabian Jasek as his student, and who's now a professor of ecology at Catholica. So this program sort of lives on. But Francesco De Castri, now who was this guy? Well, he was got his training in Padua in Italy, and then went to Chile to work in the Department of Veterinary Science. He didn't know anything about veterinary science, but he learned very, very quickly and caused a great furor down there in that department about how to do things better. I'll come back to him in a second. And at this time, when we were down in Chile, there was a new program of evolving called the International Biological Program, and that was centered on productivity, the global productivity. Frank Blair, who was the chair of the U.S. IGBP, he wanted to slip in a little bit of evolution. And so he started a program, wanted some aspects of it to be an evolution. And so at that first meeting of the IBP in Caracas, Venezuela, we proposed a convergent evolution program between California and Chile and elsewhere. So that became an official part of the program. Then after my sabbatical, or during the same sabbatical year, I went on to France to meet Ecar, working on the pioneering physiological ecologist working in the field. And then later on in 74, went to South Africa and Australia to meet Fred Krueger, who was very important, I think, in the early days of this program. Ralph Slatcher, Ian Noble, went to Australia and met them, and so I was got a chance to meet personally with some of the leaders in these fields around the world. These people I met and interacted with were also important in future programs that were to develop, like the Global Invasive Species Program. Ralph Slatcher was very important in that because Fred Krueger and I proposed to do a Mediterranean comparison of invasive species around the world. And Slatcher was on the board of Scientific Committee on Problems of the Environment and said, why do that? Why not do two other things? One, be sure not just to look at invasive species, but look at the management aspects, which we did. But secondly, why not do it for the world? And so it became a global project rather than just a Mediterranean project because of Ralph Slatcher. And then I guess a further connection with De Castri. De Castri became involved in a global invasive species program because he moved from Chile. We built this program around this guy in Valdivia, and he left and went to UNESCO to become head of the Man in the Biosphere program. We were all set to do a comparison between San Francisco area, the North Bay, and in Valdivia, equal latitudes, and he left. And so all this, and once he left, we had to switch from Valdivia to Santiago, where the scientist's base was, and that meant we had to move from San Diego San Francisco down to San Diego. So his moving changed the whole structure of what we were doing. I never quite forgave him for that, although I did like San Diego. Okay, this was the beginnings of the project. Very important people, and that to the right-hand side, standing by that weather shelter, that quaint little weather shelter, was Ernesto Hayek, who was the right-hand man of Francesco de Castro, worked on the climate comparison. And the person in the center with his back to us, he's already looking down. This is Jochen Kummerhoff. He's looking for the roots, but he can't see the roots because of the soil in the way, and he was trying to design a transparent soil so he could do his work. He did a tremendous amount of work on chaparral root systems in this project. And some of the people that went down from the north to the beginnings of this project, Phil Miller on the far right, was a tremendously talented system scientist who was very important for the work, and unfortunately we lost him too early in the program. His family to the left, and some of the San Diego people to the far left that some of you know, I'm sure. That woman on the far right there, she has a look of, what are we doing here? What's this all about? And are we sure we're doing the right thing? I've watched that face now for 37 years, and that's what that look means. I know that. Phil Miller, he took, for the modeling work of the chaparral, Monterol, the climate interactions, he had been working in the mangroves, so he just took his mangrove model. He said, all you have to do is just sort of shrink it down, same model, and then he brought down his mobile lab to Chile, was part of our original project. We had, this project was supported by the National Science Foundation, and they're always very picky about their money, so they sent down a very distinguished reviewer, Dan Janssen, an eminent evolutionary biologist, to see whether we're doing it right, and see he's checking on, see if that line is straight. The I was working really hard. I was doing the management of all this, so I went to find out where the local supply of chicha was to make sure the troops were well supplied. This was a really interesting project, I think, because it was an integrated project. What a joke. Integrated. It had botanists, it had zoologists, it had geographers. No, integrated project in those days. But it was, because these were separate disciplines and they didn't talk to one another. But no matter who was working on the project, whether they're working on salamanders or whether they're working on plants, whether they're working in physiology or whatever it was, there was a very simple question that they all addressed. It was integrated in that way. And we had a series of stations along the gradient. And the question was the structure or the function of system X more like at matched sites on continent, between continents, and adjacent sites on the same continent? Simple question, and very important to get that answer. And everyone could relate to it, and everyone could understand it, whether it was climate or whether it was frogs. So the first meeting, Ray Specht was there from Australia, one of the first people working, doing some comparisons. These were before we had done the comparative study. Peter Raven, one of the world's most eminent botanist. He actually also started his career at UCLA as a graduate student, but he was so good as a graduate student, he had his own graduate students. A remarkable guy, but he then, like me, he went north to Stanford for a few years, but unlike me, he didn't stay. He went on to Missouri Botanical Garden. But he did, his work was important in this context because, you know, we talk about invasive species. Well, what happened before globalization? And he did a study comparing those things which did transcontinental movement. There weren't many. Martin Cody was at that first meeting. Zev Neve, a remarkable guy we'll hear more about. So, and Paul Lassant, he was in the IBP, but he was more on the biogeochemistry side than more the functional side. So we had, I just want to talk about one other meeting, the second meeting, which was held in at Stanford, and the consequences of fire and fire management in Mediterranean systems. Phil Rundle and John Keeley were at those meetings, the first ones I guess they went to, as was Ian Noble, Harold Biswell, Fred Krueger, Zev Neve, Ed Komarek and Richard Gross. Ed Komarek was sort of the founder of fire science in this country. And so we thought we'd have him give a keynote speech. Boy, I said, Ed, this is an after-dinner speech, 20 minutes. I saw him 10 minutes later, I said, Ed, this is a keynote speech after dinner, you know, it's after dinner, 20 minutes. And then he introduced him, and he starts. He says, there's the fire, there's water, there's earth, and there's the sky. And he starts out, and he goes on, and he starts talking, and he goes on. An hour went by. An hour and 20 minutes went by, and then finally one of my colleagues, more guts than I had, get up and start blinking the lights on and off, and I think Ed finally got the clue and sat down. So that was one of the more humiliating incidents of my career. Okay, I forgot to start the time. I have 15 minutes, and I haven't even started here. I got to go fast here. Okay. Conserving our natural capital will require building a new coordinate, new partners, management challenges. I'll talk first about the new coalitions that we need, and then about the challenges that we face. The future ain't what it used to be, if it ever was. Okay, first, you know, we put most of our attention in recent years on looking at the main systems that we deal with, the marine and marine influence, freshwater control, forests and woodlands, shrublands and grasslands, what's there, how it came to be, how it's structured, how they function, and so forth. But I think now the time has come, we've got to put much more emphasis on a greater weight on those human modified systems, both public and private. Look at all these systems which cover a large part of our countries, the fisheries, the agriculture, the rangelands, production forests, urban ecosystems, the major rivers which have been modified, parklands, the working landscapes. And a lot of these are in public ownership, and for conservation, you got to worry about these a lot. One example I think is really important for us in Mediterranean regions, of these particularly in the true Mediterranean region and in California, are these woodlands. In California, 80% of the oak woodlands are in private ownership. There's a storehouse of incredible diversity in these areas, and they're all on private ownership, but they're actually well cared for in many ways. The ranchers taking care of these areas are the stewards of the landscape. We're losing those lands due to wine. I hate to badmouth wine, but why in the hell are they going up and destroying these beautiful oak woodlands? You know, to rip up an apple orchard is one thing, but to rip up an oak woodlands, another matter. So how do we maintain these systems? What can we do to maintain the kinds of stewards that we have on the land, which are protecting the biodiversity? We're actually enhancing biodiversity. They're enhancing fire control. There are many services that they're providing. We have the same thing, the same kinds of systems in Spain, that Tejesa, and in Portugal, we're going to hear a lot about. There's a big group on that. And these systems are multi-purpose, and they're disappearing because of for different reasons. In California, it's mainly because of development. So these lands have multiple ecosystem services. And Kenneth Tate, who is doing work on water relations on these systems, he said, this is what's expected of us now. We've got to control the weeds, we've got to conserve native species, we've got to provide clean water, sequester carbon, could have said, and reduce fire hazard, and maintain the cultural values. Those systems are a great storehouse of cultural diversity. How are we going to do that? Well, one great hope is to develop ecosystem marketplaces for these things. There's an international program now which is devoted to these working landscapes. It's called Satayama. It was launched in the Conference of the Parties of the Convention on Biological Diversity just last fall, integrating conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity in production landscapes. So that's why Japan was a leader in this is because they're worried about the loss of people from the land and the loss of cultural diversity, but they're also loss of biological diversity. So the approach is to see threefold approach. Number one is looking at securing diverse ecosystem services and values. They think that's one route to preserving those systems. Well, the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment was an effort to bring a new dimension to conservation science, and that was to build on the ecosystem service concept. So that was the beginning of getting the tools to do what we need to preserve some of these landscapes. And it viewed ecosystems and hence biodiversity in terms of benefits ecosystem services delivered to society. That was a big phase shift in the kinds of efforts in conservation biology, not just preservation for preservation's sake and eco services and so forth, but services to society. So how can we build on this foundation? Why is this thing keep beeping here, Mike? That movement, that was a one-off study, a one-off thing. It had a big impact. It's influenced in this country. All the agencies are built in this concept into their operation. We've got to do more. We've got to continue this. And how can we do it? It essentially was an IPCC for biodiversity. Can we continue on? And 6 years ago, an effort was started to do just that. It takes that long, 6 years. An effort was proposed to have a continuing IPCC-like structure for biodiversity, and we've actually achieved that. This last year, we finally got intergovernmental approval after a gazillion meetings, three intergovernmental meetings. It was finally approved, and we're going to have now, it's going to affect us all, it's going to affect you in this room, a new intergovernmental platform for biodiversity and ecosystem services. And these will be done at regular intervals. It's going to be actually bigger and better than the IPCC because it's going to have a capacity building component. It's going to have a policy interaction implementation component and the generation of knowledge. So that's a hope that we can get the knowledge to do the kinds of things that we need to do. Well, what can we do as a group here? You know, we all are doing our little bits of individual work, and can we do something together as we did in some of the original programs, more integrated? And we certainly can be all working toward developing scenarios for the future, for options for deflecting unfavorable outcomes, which are generic for all Mediterranean regions, and actually those things which are important for systems anywhere. Now, the problems that we face in doing this, this is from Richard Hobbs's work, the problems that we face are enormous. The abiotic climate change is altering, but biotic composition is also altering invasive species. And so that's going to make our job much and much more difficult. So we have to be thinking to the future, not what we have. I've talked about trying to maintain these working landscapes, but those working landscapes are going to be changing, and how can we alter them or have their trajectory go in directions which are more favorable? This is again from Hobbs and his friends, looking at what we need to do in management. It's conservation, passive restoration, active restoration, designer ecosystems, anticipatory conservation. So just we're going to be challenged enormously in the years ahead to try to maintain the diversity that we have and to build new systems which will deliver services that we all require. Looking down there. And in doing this work, we're going to have to be thinking, you know, we have to be reactive, we have to be proactive. This just shows a model that was put together in this paper, just came out in Bioscience for invasive species, what you would do. But the important part of this model, which I don't have enough time to talk about is that it's you have to not only be proactive, but you also have to include, you have to be, you as working scientists have to be interacting with the social system, which is also providing the tools that you need to make it all work, and changing the paradigms, changing the goals, and so forth. So this is our challenge for the future. Now, there's one thing which has been missing in all of this. At the Convention on Biological Diversity, the big COP10 meeting, the goal for 2010 was to stop the rate of loss of biodiversity. Well, we failed miserably at that. But one of the reasons we didn't even know whether we failed or not, because we don't have a baseline. And so we need one additional thing besides the assessment process, this new platform, the research we're already doing. We have policy instruments already out there, but we don't have the observations. And the last thing I want to talk about here is this global GEOBOND, the Global Observation for Global Observation System for Biological Diversity, which is part of a larger effort to look at of total Earth system observation system. Biodiversity is just one of those: agriculture, climate, energy. And this is now ramping up, and I think that we all have to be engaged in that. So we need to get involved in IPBES, we need to get involved in GEOBOND. We need to start thinking maybe more as a group together what we can do for the future. This is the roadmap for IPBES, for the GEOBOND. The main thing I want to say, it's going to have input from systematics on up through ecology, ecosystems, and then delivering products at the far right on conservation plans and ecosystem services. Bob Scholes from South Africa is leading this operation. And one last thing, why can't we get together like the polar community did? You know, in the IBP, we had two communities which interacted internationally. One was us, and the other was the tundra. Well, the tundra one sort of disappeared, but this last couple of years, they had an international polar year. 200 projects involving 50,000 people from more than 60 countries. An interdisciplinary approach, incorporating physical and biological sciences with a large education component. A very, very successful, ambitious program. That could be us. This is what they sold their program on. We got a problem up here in the north. How can we sell our program? So first, before I say that, is things that we ought to be worrying about. What are the greatest challenges that society at large is facing in Mediterranean ecosystems? And how can we provide information to meet these challenges? What is particularly unique about these systems that could serve as a focal point for new work that can contribute to the response of society everywhere to the impacts of global change? And I think there are those things. And if there's anything, this is one of the key points, but there are many others. So with that, I'd like to say we have a lot of great people in this room, a lot of talented people, and I think that we're all doing a lot of wonderful work we're going to hear about in the next couple of days. I've read those abstracts. But I think we can do stuff together and in a more integrated way, and that's what I'd like to propose. Thank you very much.